Good afternoon or good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This talk is about robotics. It's a general overview of where it is going, where it started from, and where it is going. And so just a slide for history. We can see that Asimov proposed the three laws of robotics in 1941, when there was no robot around. The first industrial robot, which is this creature here, it's a hydraulic robot. It was created in 1961. And then the first electrical robot, this one was designed and built at Stanford University. So you can see, not many years ago, that we had no robots at all. Also, there is a question of about what is a robot. And this is a very hard question to, it's very difficult to give a definition on this. There are many. I would say that a robot is something that moves, that can be reprogrammed, and that it's partly autonomous. So this is something short, and I think it covers a lot of the things that you will see. Here's the roadmap. We'll see how the robots that exist and we have in our minds. Then we'll see where the robots are going and the connection between robotics and universities, companies, and entrepreneurs. We'll talk about the robotics explosion that is about to happen or is already happening, and conclude this talk. So the robots, if you ask somebody what is a robot, probably he or she will think about industrial robots, like those here who, that are work in a manufacturing plant for cars. Or, so that's one poll. The second is robots in science fiction, Star Wars and RoboCop, etc. This doesn't exist, of course. But if we look at numbers and we look at worldwide robot sales, you see that the yellow part is the industrial robot sector. And this is about stable, doesn't increase a lot. And it's very small compared to the blue part, which increases drastically and dramatically. And this is this includes this what is called service robots, so industrial robots and service robots. So the robots, as they turn out to be, are very different from the simple picture of an industrial robot assembling in a plant. And we can divide those service robots in two categories: the professional and the domestic ones. Professional ones, we can say that these are robots which are dedicated to terrestrial applications, aerial, underwater, space, defense, and medical. Whereas the domestic are related to, these are robots related to our own lives and to the mass market, and we'd say it in, we include here robots that are dedicated to the care for the elders, housekeeping robots, friends, in quotation marks, toys and entertainment and educational robots. So the explosion of these service robots is fueled by new needs, and some of them include the fact that we want robots to do things that we don't want to do, and we don't want to do dirty jobs like cleaning up a nuclear site, contaminated site like the one in Japan. And we don't want to do dull works, assembling parts, the same part every day for a year and so. We don't want to do dangerous works like those that are found in underwater, the underwater environment or the space environment. And probably some of you have seen Gravity, and you know what I mean. And distant jobs that distance may include distances in space, so that somebody is on the moon or the Mars, or telemedicine requirements, where you have a soldier in the battlefield and the surgeon is somewhere else, and there should be an operation. Otherwise, you the person will lose his or her life. So in more detail, we can have also expanded needs in security and defense. And you know, we all have heard about the drones picking up specific targets, or security in securing buildings or warehouses and so on. Then a big sector is the education and the entertainment sector, and we'll see some examples. Today's society is very different from society, say, 40 years ago. Everybody is more educated and is more close to high tech. It's the aging society, mostly in Japan, because the Japanese are very keen to see robotics in their houses. Western societies, except Japan, is not, but this is changing. And another need is is related to manufacturing. A lot of manufacturing moves to China and to the East, but there is a need for bringing back some of that manufacturing, and this can be, this need can be fulfilled by having better and more flexible robots that can do this work at home. So here I have a few pictures of service robots. Here we see a cleaning robot at the nuclear site carrying contaminated material. This is a forestry robot that I worked with when I was at McGill. This is a mining robot. And here we have a hexapod that runs. This is by Boston Dynamics. I haven't added videos, but we saw some very interesting videos at the beginning of this session. This is again Boston Dynamics. It's a quadruped carrying, it's like a mule. And this is a robot in our lab, also quadruped, but very small, with a minimum number of motors, so that it doesn't use all the energy that this one is using, or this one. These also are professional robots from the aerial, space, and underwater areas. And we can see here an ROV that has two manipulators and is remotely controlled by cable from a ship to do work in space, in underwater structures. And this is a small underwater robot that we have in the lab. Again, an ROV with a cable. This is an AUV, it's an autonomous underwater vehicle, which looks like a torpedo. And these pictures are from an expedition with MIT, Elkethe, and archaeologists in Greece, and of course us, at the Nisiros a few years ago. This is a robot that went to Mars now. It's up there and collecting the data. Orbital robots and the Canadarm with an astronaut on it. So these are space robot applications. And here you can see drones. This is a quadrotor with four motors, and this is a drone like an airplane, but it's remotely controlled. And here we have some pictures from the defense and medical areas. And here you see a robot carrying a soldier, supposedly at the battlefield. And this is another vehicle that is collecting some barrel here. This is work done in our lab, which is for training, is a training system, a haptic system for urologists, so that they can, this is the tool that is held by a practitioner, by a trainee, and there is a mechanism which reads the commands by the doctor And here you can see in computer graphics the entrance to the urethra. And if the trainee is not doing his job well, then he experiences forces on his hand and adjusts the behavior so that he learns the operation. And this is the famous Da Vinci robot operating. And this is the robot, and at some point, it's probably here, although it can't be seen very well. There is an MD with a joystick controlling the robot. And here we have some domestic robots. Perhaps the most famous is the Roomba, which was created a few years ago by iRobot, and this one can clean the house and then recharge itself and remove the dust from it. This is Sony's Aibo. It's a 20 degree of freedom, 20 motors, small robot with capabilities to communicate and to express itself. This is a robotic fish from my lab, which is autonomous in power and can communicate with the user and has a camera here in front so it can send back feedback to the operator, and there is a tail with which it moves. And this is the Morphex. It looks like a ball, but if you see it running, then it opens up, it walks, it climbs, it dances, and so on. And here, the Asimo, this little robot that we've seen earlier in a video. This is a humanoid which can express feelings. This is the PR2, which is a robot that can be used supposedly at home. It can do the laundry and so on. And these are two mobile robots that we built for Alufan Park 3 years ago. And it's a chaser, and one chases the other, and it's a game for kids to learn how to cooperate and to work with robots. Now, if we look at where is the money, we can see that these are all the units sold in 2008, and you can see that 99% of the robots are in the domestic category, and just 1% in the professional one. But if we look at the value, then you can see that 99% comes from the professional category and only 1% from the domestic, which means that there are few but expensive service robots. So most of the money comes for specific, special robots which are sold to do professional work. And if we look at manufacturers and startups, this is a global map, and this is Europe. And you can see the red dots, which are not very many, correspond to industrial robots. The blue to service robots, S is for professional, P for domestic, and the green ones for the startups. So you see it's mostly blue, and of the blue mostly is S. And in these maps we do not include the universities, which are about 225, and all the integrator, designer companies and consultants and so on. In total there are about 2,200 companies in this sector. Now, if we take a look at robotics in conjunction to universities, we'll see that the field is dominated by academic research. It's knowledge intensive. And it requires knowledge from many fields. And these typically are the electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, computer science, but now even psychology, aesthetics, design, and other things that I'm not listing here. So, and all these people have to collaborate and understand each other. And if you are versed in more than one of these areas, it's the better off you are. Now, degrees in robotics take many years because of the requirements. But the good news is that once somebody graduates from gets a robotics degree, then there are many jobs, not only in robotics, but in other areas too, because the person is not just a theoretician, but has a deep knowledge of both the hardware and the software and the integration of the system. So that helps to many of these people, especially abroad, but hopefully here too, start startup companies or spin-offs. And it's quite popular. Here I have some examples of companies in the area. The first is Rethink Robotics by Rodney Brooks, before he had Heartland Robotics and iRobot and so on. And they have here the Baxter Manufacture Robot, which is a robot for manufacturing, but is very user-friendly. So even there are eyes here, and you can, this is a touch screen, and you can program it very quick, easily, and it's somehow soft, so it's not a dangerous one. This is a picture from Blue River Technology. You have a tractor carrying these things that have cameras, detect the weeds, and they just kill the weeds and not the crops. This is a Brigo, a coffee-making machine that irritates, imitates the experts. So they have looked how an expert prepares coffee, exactly what they do, and the machine repeats over the expert. And this is Liquid Robotics Wave Glider, which is a robot that can do ocean observation and surveillance using the power from the waves. And of course, communicates with other robots of that sort, or with the bases. Some more robotics companies here. The Exobionics, they create exoskeletons like this one that you can wear, and it helps you walk when you are an elder or you can't walk on your own. This is the InTouch Health company. This is called RP Vita. It's a robot that has a screen here, and the MD appears, and so he can be at his office and visit with the robot the patients. This is a defense robot made by Robotex. It's for security or defense reasons. And this is a robot by Cubotics, where you have solar panels, and there is a robot here on a monorail that moves around and controls the attitude of the solar panel so that so that you get more power out of it. And here we have some robotics companies for domestic robots. This is the Roomba. We've seen that. And this is the Bossa Nova Robotics robot made by, that's a CMU spin-off, and it's a home robot. This is another robot that I think somebody will talk about it later, and it helps you lose weight. So you talk to it, and you have it in the kitchen, close to where the food is. And this is the Romo, is a small robot with wheels that can play with kids and pets. It runs around, you can control it, I think, with an iPhone. And the PR2 that we've seen before, that was doing various works at home, but of course, see the price tag, 400K, not for all homes. Now, there are some companies which are unusual for robotics. And these, as Vasil said before, earlier, it's Amazon, Google, and Microsoft. I'm adding it. So Amazon started this game by buying Kiva Systems, which is a warehouse robotics company, and they paid for it $775 million, which was totally absurd, and everybody started asking, why are they buying, what are they doing? And now they have this drone with eight motors, eight propellers, carrying a 5-pound, I believe, box with deliverables to homes, so it can land in front of your house and deliver what you ordered, supposedly in 30 minutes. Now, of course, there is one question: why is Amazon doing this? I would say that the answer is that they try to provide instant gratification to their customers, so that once you click and you place an order, very quickly this order is fulfilled and it is in your hands. So that's a very powerful marketing tool. And supposedly they will increase their sales, but we'll see more about this later. There is Google. Google had autonomous cars. If you have seen the movie Internship, you've seen the what is going on in Google. That was okay, but they started buying robotics companies, and by the beginning of this month, they had bought 7 of them. And now, a few days earlier, they announced that they bought Boston Dynamics, and Google is interested in data and selling data to others and getting profits from the marketing that services that it offers. So that's a guess, but we'll see. And then there is Microsoft, which some time ago started also working in robotics. They do software toolkits for robot control and simulation. So I think they are interested in selling their software mostly, but also now that the market is booming, they will have other things in their mind. Now, if we look at robotics and entrepreneurs, we could say that the biggest problem is funding. There are companies that are dedicated to fund robotics companies, like Greece in Robotics. There is also True Ventures, which funds hardware startups. And then there is crowdfunding, asking over the internet people to fund your own work. And there is a group that builds a hexapod that can carry operators on top of it, and they are building this robot based on using crowdfunding. Now, the problem with the entrepreneurial work in robotics is that it's difficult to assess success or failure. And also, it's important to be ahead of the game. But if you're ahead of the game, the competition is far behind, because it takes years to create such a company and do the work. And the good news also is that people still pay for hardware. They steal software, but they can't steal hardware. So there is money to be made there. And this picture is from a young lady in Boston who is creating those robots and selling them. And she's an entrepreneur on her own. Now, the question is, does somebody want to start up, to create a startup in robotics? Well, there are some comments here about this. These companies are supposedly expensive to fund. You need equipment, you need space, and so on. But it's not so expensive as people believe. And that's why even university labs can do a lot of things with limited money. Of course, it takes a long time to have revenue. It's not so fast as when you have a software company. You write an app and you put it, say, up for sale, and you start collecting. It's a niche market. And as I said, there is a lack of, it's difficult to get investment. It's only 0.5% of the total investment goes to robotics. And they are at an early stage, so. But that's good and bad. It's if you are at an early stage, maturity will come. And so if you are on that wave, it helps. And experience shows that robots need to fulfill unique and dedicated needs, despite the fact that we talk about reprogrammable robots and having them to do many jobs. They should be focused. They haven't reached the large market yet, and that's a challenge. But once you reach a large market, then the cost drops and you can increase your sales. And as they say, robotics is the engineer's dream, but the marketeer's nightmare, because it's how you sell this product to people. And of course, as the cost is lowered, then you can easily access mass markets, which is important. If we take a look at why robotics is exploding, we'll see that what happens is that there are technologies that come from other areas, like the mobile devices, which can be used in robotics very cheaply. For example, you can have GPS sensors, batteries of high quality, sensors, cameras, and vision software, speech recognition, wireless networking, all this is in many smartphones, so you can put it in your robot too. You have a lot of open source code, which is available and standard, and open source hardware that talks with that software. There are drivers that can connect this hardware to other hardware. So this helps the path to mass marketing robots. The technological challenges that are still with us, first of all, I would say is power, batteries or fuel cells, because all these devices consume a lot of power and they need to replenish that. It's also actuators, motors. For example, we would need stronger magnets to have stronger actuators and do the same work with less current, less power. It's also a matter of computational power, especially when you do vision or things that require intelligence, running algorithms, so that you can have better world perception, so that the robot knows where it is and what is forbidden to eat. And also, there is always a need for better artificial intelligence algorithms and overall control algorithms for the robots. So we can see here batteries, motors, and this is a PC-104 that is used to control such robots, and the rest is the artificial intelligence part. So to conclude this talk, I would say that service robots is the future, and this future is already here, but we haven't seen the whole picture yet. And there are enabling technologies that allow this to happen. Open source and technologies from other areas will help. I would say that robotics, especially this year, is highlighted by these acquisitions, mostly by Amazon and Google, and they give high visibility to the domain. And so that allows robotics to penetrate into the business world and be taken more seriously. Now, robotics is exploding at this point. The game is changing, and it's moving towards the mass market. And we'll see what happens if those who say that the robotics industry today is where the PC industry was in the early 80s, we'll see if this is true or not. And of course, there is a big challenge to Greek researchers and engineers to join this area, partly because robotics requires is knowledge intensive, and this knowledge is here. We have people who are well trained and can do these things. The costs are not that high. Good ideas will help. And I guess some of you who are here with us are interested in this, and I wish you all the best. Thank you very much.